We often get inquiries about the ability to hunt wild pigs and how that can lead to control. And the truth is, recreational sport hunting will not control a wild pig population. Most of the studies that have been conducted in the southeastern United States indicate that somewhere between about 8% and 50%, with the average being about 23%, of a wild pig population can be controlled by recreational hunting. With the need to control between 50% and 70% of a given population just to hold that population stable, recreational hunting in and of itself is not the answer. Now, certainly it can generate income to many Texas landowners interested in leasing hunting rights for wild pigs, and certainly with our lack of seasons and lack of bag limits, you can hunt those wild pigs anytime. It does represent a recreational opportunity, but recreational hunting by itself is not a viable control technique. We have basically four methods that we can use to control or manage wild pig populations in the state of Texas. I mentioned hunting, and for recreational hunters, they're required to have a state of Texas general hunting license in order to be able to hunt those wild pigs. However, the legislature has granted landowners some degree of flexibility in that if wild pigs are causing damage on a property, that landowner and or that landowner's agent can go in and control those wild pigs by any legal means necessary without having the benefit of a hunting license. So that flexibility does exist for landowners and their agents. However, for recreational hunters that are going to perhaps take those pigs and use the meat, or they're hunting strictly for recreational purposes, whether they're in-state hunters or out-of-state hunters, they need to have a state of Texas valid hunting license with them during the pursuit of that activity. There's other forms of shooting as well as recreational hunting. Many landowners and hunters will shoot at night. That's when wild pigs are most active, particularly if they've been pressured. They're highly nocturnal, and many individuals go out using night vision equipment or spotlights to pursue wild pigs at night. And so we need to separate that type of shooting from recreational hunting in many cases, because typically that is purposeful to reduce damage and not a recreational pursuit per se. So we're trying to reduce damage by reducing the size of that wild pig population. So shooting, both recreational hunting and tactical shooting, I'll call it, particularly at night, where you're trying to reduce populations. And then a third type of shooting is actual aerial shooting done primarily by helicopter. And Wildlife Services, for example, removes about 25,000 pigs a year in the state of Texas. Half of that number is by aerial shooting. But in addition, there's a number of private companies that offer hunters an opportunity to shoot from a helicopter. And this became legalized September 1, 2011. And now we have a number of individuals that are permitted to shoot on private land from the air. So shooting from the air, tactical shooting from the ground, and recreational hunting, the three of those represent about 35% of some 750,000 pigs removed annually in the state of Texas. The second method that's used widely as a control method to reduce damage for wild pigs in the state of Texas is trapping. And trapping represents about 57% of that 750,000 pigs removed annually. But trapping has to be done using a set of what I'll refer to as best management practices to be successful. I believe trapping is the first line of defense for most Texas landowners, but they need to go about a process or a protocol to be successful at that trapping endeavor. The days of throwing a trap out, putting bait in it, and coming back and removing wild pigs the next morning are gone in the state of Texas. Many of these pigs have been pressured, and they've become very smart and very nocturnal as a result in response to that pressure. So we have to go through a purposeful event in order to be successful with our trapping enterprises. And you can see in the background here, we've got a corral trap set up. This corral trap's quite large, consisting of about 7 16-foot long, 5-foot high panels, with those panels having 4x4-inch square mesh and T-post about every 4 to 5 feet. This is a quite large trap, but if you're dealing with a large number of pigs, then the idea is to maximize the distance between the gate opening and the trigger, which is located at the far end of the trap. The idea is you want the last pig to have time to enter that trap before the first pig trips the trigger. But we back up and talk about how do we determine what size trap to build. We start with the use of a remote sensing camera, which you see located on the rear of the trap. Before I ever erect a trap, I want to make sure I have that wild pig group or sounder on bait. And once you've got them on bait, then you can erect a trap of the appropriate size. You determine that you've got those pigs on bait by setting up your remote sensing camera and documenting those pigs are actually using the bait. Once you do that, you also determine how many pigs are in that sounder. That's the information you need to erect a trap of the appropriate size. It may be a 3 or 4 panel trap, or it may be a quite large trap like this one that's got 7, 8, maybe even 10 16 to 20 foot long panels in it. And then that camera is your guide to as you train those pigs on the bait and train them to go in and out of the trap with the gate wired open. Your camera is your guide to let you know when those pigs are accustomed to that trap, and then you can actually set it to catch. It may take a week from the time you have them on bait to the time you trap them, or if it's a group of pigs that have been highly pressured through hunting, through trapping activity, it may be a month or more before you can have them acclimated to that bait, used to going in and out of the trap, and you can actually set it to catch. But if you'll go through that process of training them on bait, erecting a trap of the appropriate size, and then training them to be comfortable with going in and out of that trap with the gate wired open, then you can be assured that once you set that trap to catch based on your camera data, you'll be successful. We've got several different gate designs that you can use. We've got a saloon door gate. We've got a rooter gate that's actually held up in a position such as that. And then the trigger extends back into the trap, and when it's tripped, it will close. And then we've got a swinging door gate, much like a screen door, that can be wired open and then closed once it's tripped. The common denominator of all three of these type gates, the swinging door, the saloon, and the rooter gate, is that they're called continuous catch gates. That means even once they're tripped and pigs are inside, you can catch additional pigs by them pushing through any of these three types of gates. The problem is our camera data now tells us that once these gates close, additional pigs seldom, if ever, push in to a closed gate. Even though they're capable of doing it, it very seldom happens. So this has opened the door to go back and reuse a gate style that we probably started with 30 to 50 years ago, and that's just a guillotine gate that drops straight down, and once it's closed, additional pigs are not able to enter. So at the present time, those are the only four techniques, and I'll go over those again. We've got shooting, both from the ground and aerially. We've got trapping, which is the first line of defense for most Texas landowners. We've got snaring, and then we've got the use of specially trained dogs. And at this point in time, in the state of Texas, as well as the United States, those are the only four legal methods we have to control wild pigs. There's some excellent research being conducted at the present time on the use of toxicants, but until that technique is approved and available to Texas landowners, we have to be satisfied with managing the damage and not eradicating the wild pigs. We've been very successful with that, in that several studies have been conducted that we've been able to reduce the economic impact wild pigs had on agricultural operations by as much as 66%. So if we can reduce a landowner's agricultural damage by 2/3, then that's a step in the right direction towards limiting the impact wild pigs have to agriculture in the state of Texas.